Hello, everybody, and welcome to a new series we're starting here on ChannelFireball.com called Arcane Lab. So, before we get started, I did want to talk to you real quick about what you can expect from the series and what you can't expect from the series, slash might be better to go somewhere else for. My name is Gaby Spartz, if we've never met before, and one of my favorite things in the whole wide world is to play tier 1.5 plus decks. I really like the decks that are doing different things, that are doing cute things, that have cool combos or different combos. And it's just one of the things that I really, really, really find exciting in playing Magic, is just like playing these kind of like off the beaten path decks that are trying to do something cute, and maybe they're not like the literal best deck ever, but it is really fun when you get to do the thing. As such, this series is very much focused on those kinds of decks. So if you're looking for like, what deck should I play at the PTQ this weekend, or like, what is my sideboard guide for like trying to do well in the MCQ? This is not gonna be it, you know? And I think there's a ton of amazing content creators on ChannelFireball.com if you want that kind of content. But here we're gonna focus on fun, we're gonna focus on different decks, we're gonna focus on trying to get these combos to work, and not necessarily like the meta deck of the week or like the tightest technical gameplay. So I did just want you to kind of have an expectation for what we're trying to do in this specific series. And also, if you have any decks that you think you'd be fun for the Arcane Lab, you can just send them to me. My Twitter account is at Gaby Spartz. And it's a super easy way to get in touch with me. So if you have a deck that you think would be cool, or you've been working on some sort of combo, you'd want to see it go through the gauntlet, rise to the challenge, try to actually get some match wins, feel free to send that to me. So today we are playing with Bad Kitties. This is a kind of like a variant of decks that exists right now, all centered around the card Cauldron Familiar and Witch's Oven. So the way it works is Cauldron Familiar is kind of like an unassuming, totally like not scary looking card. It's a 1 mana 1/1. When it ETBs, you drain one. So they lose one, I gain one. And then you can sack a food to return it from the graveyard to the battlefield. So you can get it straight there. And then the combo is with a card Witch's Oven. So Witch's Oven is a 1 mana artifact. You tap, sack a creature, and you make a food. And if it was toughness 4 or greater, you make two foods instead. Two foods. Two food tokens. So that the second clause almost never comes up with this deck, for what it's worth. But it's just good to keep in mind, because you do have one card that can trigger it. And then outside of that, you have a lot of cards that care about either creatures entering the battlefield for you or creatures dying. So like, what are our combos? We have things like Ayara. So Ayara is like an extra Cauldron Familiar that stays on the board. So every time you go through one of these cycles, or actually, let me backtrack for a second. The combo here is completely free. So for every time you can sack a Cauldron Familiar, you can get it back and do that cycle once. So you only need one cat, but multiple Witch's Ovens get to continue cycling the familiar. So because it's free, you can just do that at the end of the turn. And if you have a Yara in play, you get to sack the Cauldron Familiar to the Witch's Oven, bring it back, and when it comes back, it triggers, and then a Yara triggers too. So now you drain them for two, I gain two. And then you have a couple other cards that serve a similar purpose. For example, Sir Conrad does the same thing. It just is another way to drain them. And then you have a lot of cards that care about your creatures dying. So for example, you have Midnight Reaper, who draws you cards. So every time you go through one of those Cauldron Familiar cycles, you can also draw a card from Midnight Reaper. And because you have these cards that are like easy to sack and like not a huge cost to sacking them, that makes stuff like Rankle really good, because Rankle can have your opponent sack a creature as well. You lose a Gutter Bones, which is like whatever. They might lose an actual good card. And then for discarding card and losing one life, it's just like you just get to dome them for a little bit more. So something that's interesting with this deck is that it actually plays out kind of like a burn deck a little bit, which is not really what it looks like, but that is how it ends up playing out quite a bit. So in the end, like Priest of the Forgotten Gods is good because you have them, you know, sack a creature, but at some point in the game, this is just turns like two to the face, right? Same for Dread Presence. Dread Presence is like card advantage in a pinch, but also usually with this, you're just like playing a swamp and then just doming them. So that's a little bit about this deck. What else are we missing that I didn't talk about? So some people are playing the like Rat Piper. I forget his name. I've been trying Order of Midnight just because it's pretty nice for like you sack a creature to Wrenkle and you just get it back with order, or like sometimes you end up sacking these creatures to the priest and you might not have food to get it back, like the cat. Sometimes you can like Order of Midnight to get back some of these guys, or if you like, if your murderous rider somehow ends up in the yard, you can bring it back. It's really nice with the Midnight Reapers because then you just get more card advantage. Also, it's just like a 2/2 flyer. Sometimes that's like all you really need to attack your opponent. So sometimes you just play it on curve on two and boom. Yeah, that's a little bit about the deck. You're also playing 20 of the prettiest swamps in all of Magic, all Mirage swamps. And then you also have two Castle Lochthwain. I think that's how you say that. So something that's a little awkward with Castle is that it's very good in this deck. The one thing is you're playing four Dread Presence. It's one of your better cards. So if you have too many Castles, then your Dread Presences don't trigger. So you don't want to play too many. It's also pretty important to play it early in the curve. So that eventually when you have a Dread Presence, every time you draw a swamp, you can actually use it instead of like you playing like all your swamps, then playing Castle. When you have Dread Presence in play, you don't get to trigger it at all. So that's a little bit about the main deck. There are variants of this deck that are pretty interesting. There's like a red black variant. I've just been playing this mono black version. Then for the sideboard, and just to keep in mind, we're gonna go into best of one just because I like showing the deck against multiple decks a little bit better than just like playing one best of three match. So I'll talk about the sideboard and then in case you want to play it in best of three. So we have three Drill Bits. Drill Bits really awesome in this deck because you have so many ways of triggering Spectacle that basically this is like a Thought Seize for your opponent. There's like real downsides to Drill Bit, right? It's not Thought Seize, but in this deck it's almost always Thought Seize. So this is really good against the Golos decks. Like a lot of times you just want to take the card Golos from them. Like that's a really big problem. So Drill Bit is really helpful there. The Duresses are good in the same matchups, but they're also good against like the Jeskai decks, like the Jeskai Fires decks. They can be good against the Doomfall decks and stuff like that. The Disfigure is just... Sorry, that's loud. A lot of times like Knight of Ebon Legion is kind of annoying for this deck. So like Disfigure is just a way to take care of like the small red creatures or the small... Because there's like a pretty popular mono black like beatdown deck. It's good against that deck as well. Legion's End is good against small creature decks, also pretty good against the Golos decks, and Golos is just like everywhere in the ladder right now, so you have to be prepared. It both kills Hydrate Krasis, hopefully takes one of them away from their hand, and also is just able to kill all the zombies really quickly, though that's not like a really good strategy against them. That matchup is tough. Then you have four Noxious Grasp that are good against both. So Questing Beast is a real problem for this deck. You have like no way to block it. Like almost none of your creatures can. Or even like trade with it. So Noxious Grasp is great at that. The only other way you have to kill Questing Beast in this deck is like Murderous Rider or Blocks or Conrad. So like not exactly where you want to be at. Noxious Grasp is also good against the Teferi decks. So this is a little bit about Bad Kitties, aka Cauldron Familiar, Witch's Oven / Mono Black Cats. So I'm going to have the link listed in the description for this. And you're going to be able to see that on CFB. I think at the moment you can't export directly straight out. I hope they're able to get that going soon. But if not, you can always use another website to like convert it into MTG Arena format. This hand's pretty good. We get to go Cauldron Familiar into Priest into a Yara. We draw land. It's a pretty good hand. I would love the Oven. The Oven would be amazing. Okay, so they mulligan, it seems like. Yeah, they want a 6. Okay, so let's just kitty and go. Temple of Mystery. So we're playing against like Simic Food. Could also be... Ooh, drawing a land there was awesome. Could also be like Bant Food, could also be like Golos, like the Golos decks play such random lands. Okay, it looks like it might just be like Bant stuff. So here we want to play that Castle over the Swamp. Just in case we do end up drawing, what's his face? Dread Presence. Okay, so we have some stuff going here. Go ahead and attack with these two bad boys. I would like to draw something that's not I mean, I would love it if they played a creature. Because just playing out Murderous Rider just as a 2-3 feels like pretty bad. Not much of a choice though. Okay, I think we just attack with everybody. We could start using a Yara to try to draw cards, but I don't think, since we have no cauldron, like, I don't really want to lose my cat. If they have Time Wipe next turn, they could really get me good. I think it's probably worth it to play the Murderous Rider because we have this castle. So we get to drain them there, we just have more attackers, and then also we want to empty out our hand so this castle doesn't just dormant a million every time we activate it. No Time Wipe! No Time Wipe, please! Please! Okay, that's actually fine. That means that they, like, this is just not even, like, that good for them. So we could make them sack this. I don't even know if that's super helpful. I do have a like backup a Yara basically. So what we could do is attack with Rider and a Yara. They probably don't block. Then post combat I could sack the Cauldron Familiar and a Yara to the priest to draw an extra card, then follow up with another a Yara. I don't even know if that's like that good. Interesting. So this to me tells me that to me feels like they have another Wrath. So let's play a Swamp, not play the follow-up Ayara pass. I think they're gonna Wrath us here. We get to sack some stuffs and then we get to also activate the castle. But yeah, like I otherwise I can't explain like just jumping like that. It just doesn't feel like it accomplishes anything. It's holding back the Cauldron Familiar and the Priest, so like no reason to just throw it away. Yeah, there it is. So let's sack. Target you. And let's sack Cauldron Familiar in a Yara. Oh, we drew an oven. Might as well activate this with the mana we have floating. It's not actually going to make a difference, but... Okay, so it dies. Which is fine. And now we can play castle again. We can play an oven. And a Yara. And if something goes sideways here, I can at least get the witch's oven back. Or like, I can get the food back with a Yara. Otherwise, we're going to have to try to have this attack. So if they have a Hydrid Crisis here, we're like not in amazing shape. They're gonna draw two, go to eight, draw two more cards, have a like pretty big blocker. These castles are gonna have to do some heavy lifting. It's kind of annoying. All right, I don't believe I'm gonna sack the Yara to the Witch's Oven just because this does help burn so much. But I would love to draw like a Gutter Bones or something. Come on. Let's activate this and... Okay, that's a start. So we can go Gutter Bones. Drain them. We can sack the Gutter Bones, get Cauldron Familiar back, drain them for another two, and then activate to get Gutter Bones back in hand. That seems like a pretty good turn. So sack this, get food. Bring back kitty cat. I guess technically I don't have to bring the kitty cat back yet. I can just activate this to get it back in hand. And then we'll bring back the kitty at some point. It's gonna dome them for two. And this can block here at the very least. Okay, oof. The Hydrid Crisis now is like super, super scary. I don't think we can beat that if they play that. Please don't do it. Oh my gosh. Rats foiled again. They're only getting two from this, so it could be worse. If they had a land, so they must not have one because they didn't play one. They would have gained another life and they would have gained, like, drawn an extra card. Okay. It's probably attack with Golos and nothing else. That's fine. No blocks. That's fine. Let me go ahead and get this back. Okay, well, they are kind of going off, so I do need to kill them soon. Grazer? I think they have a... So they drew multiple lands, because before they didn't... Yeah, they must have. That's kind of weird. Okay, so let's go swamp into Gutter Dad. Gutter Dad. We can sack the familiar. Get it back. It drains another time. Oh yeah, we have enough. Okay, so we can go sack... the cat. Get it back. And then we can use a Yara to sack a Gutter Bones. Okay, well, we drew another Witch's Oven, but we could just pay to get the Gutter Bones back, replay the Gutter Bones, and then that pings them with a Yara, and boom! Pew, pew, pew! Look at them kitty cats doing the thing. That was like a game. It was actually very close. They were like really turning the corner at the end. The Ayara was the key to everything. Sir Alex? All right, let's battle. Ooh, this thing's kind of cool. I wish it were the other way around. I wish we had two ovens and one cat, but this is still a pretty cool hand. More ovens is always better. Temple of Triumph, so this might be knights? Like, Mardu knights, maybe? We still get to go Swamp, Cauldron Familiar into Swamp, Cauldron Familiar, Witch's Oven. Oh, this is like Jeskai Walkers. No, my cat! Okay, well, they can't do that anymore because now I'm gonna have a Witch's Oven. So, it's not actually that big a deal that we lost it. Three Fairy? Alright. I'm probably gonna bounce my Witch's Oven. Yeah, so let me use it real quick before it goes away. The nice thing is we are going to be able to kill Teferi with a cat. Though if they do play a... Oh, that's not super helpful. I actually would have really liked to draw land there. So let's go another Cauldron Familiar and Witch's Oven. And then we can attack Teferi. Wait, Teferi. Hit him. Get him! Boom. Now what? Okay, if they have a... yeah, I was gonna say, they have Fires of Invention. I'm like not loving our spot. They didn't have a follow-up? Their hand is, has to be all fives. That's really weird. Okay, I am not loving our spot. I think we need a Nayara, like, stat. Unfortunate. I mean, these cats are doing the best they can, but... With a Yara, I think we could actually try to bring them out. I think now I worry that they're just gonna play, like, a bunch of five Planeswalkers and I'm just dead. Like, are they gonna Sarkin me? Yeah. Cinder Planar Bacon is so obnoxious. So their prob's making a dragon. Yep. Now follow up, interesante. Okay, well, the Inner Planar Beacon is kind of like foiling our plans. If we draw an extra cauldron, and then we are able to resolve an Ayara, maybe we have a chance, but we keep drawing really expensive cards. Yeah, I can't really attack while they have Sarkin in play. That's too bad. Because usually you can attack like no fear when you have a Witch's Oven because you just sack whatever gets blocked. God, if they Chandra me here. Don't do it! Don't do it! Sure. God, if we had another land, we could just murder this writer of this thing. It's so brutal. Ow. Yeah. I think I called literally because my opponent cast this game. Feels bad, man. Yeah.
Oh, looks like someone's getting a little sweaty.
Yeah, that's me. That would be me. I think we're just dead now. We missed too many land drops. Oh. Sure, so I take 18. Oh no. Doesn't even do anything. Can't even block. Or can't attack. It's funny, their Fires of Invention this game hasn't actually done anything. Like, it let them cast a Sarkin when they had a temple one of those turns, but it's not clear that they didn't have an untapped land. And then the following turn, they just could have cast a Chandra and they never cast two spells. Yeah, we're almost certainly dead. So even if we drew a land, could we, like, stitch together some miracle? We can't ever attack, so we would murderous rider to kill the Sarkin. Attack with everybody for 4. One more cycle of Cauldron Familiar, and that's 5. That's a shame. Yeah, I think they just want to make sure they don't die to, like, some nonsense. But that was gonna be, like, our only out, is if we strung together some miracle, but I believe we're just dead. I guess I'll look at my draw step. Okay, let's just be done here. Let us be done here. We are daubers. Man, I think we had a really good chance that game. Because the way it would have worked is we would have had a Yara in play. And then the following turn... I mean, it might have played out differently, obviously. But then the following turn, we actually have like a murderous rider to kill the Sarkin the first time. So then we just have to deal with a 4-4, which is going to be a problem. But okay, we're going to go... Look at this mono black aggro beatdown plan. Gutterbones into Gutterbones, Gutterbones. Alright, let's do this. Alright. I believe it's technically right for them to just draw their card and then decide if they want a Once Upon a Time because then they have more information. But I also respect just wanting to cast that card because it's exciting. Ooh, hello. Okay, so with that draw, I actually want to slow roll these gutter bones because they ping when Ayara's in play. Like, this is a pretty good spot to play another Gutter Bones and sack them both. I gotta sneeze. My gosh, excuse me. Yeah, so we play Gutter Bones and have them sack, and I think it does have to be Gutter Bones. So target you. Sack my. Actually, I guess technically I could just attack with a Gutter Bones and see if they block. It's gonna be super telegraphed because I literally just did this. But also, I think we would take that trade. Like, that would be completely fine. Look at our mind games. Let's see if we get in our head. I think they're gonna trade. Okay, that's actually good. I'm super happy with this. This is totally fine. I would have never thought they were trade. Okay, never mind. All right, well, we got in two cheeky points of damage. So target them and sack these two. I want to do this now because I want the mana. Okay, so sack your dude. So now we can play a Yara. Yeah. And then land and Gutter Bones again. Okay. Not a bad turn. The next turn we can probably play Midnight Reaper and just jam. Oh, I'm actually kind of tempted to kill that Golden Goose so they just can't ramp. So they just can't ramp anymore. If I play Cauldron Familiar. God, I wish I had just like a little bit more mana so I could do all of this while I have Midnight Reaper in play. But that's okay. I think we attack with a Yara and Gutter Bones. Yeah. See what they do. Nothing. We could also just like play Midnight Reaper and then just be down to sack that and a Gutter Bones depending on what they play. It's kind of annoying because they just have a Gilded Goose, so they can just sack that. The most annoying thing that would happen is if they play Nissa next turn. I really don't want them to. So I think that does make it so that I bring Gutter Bones back. I recast Gutter Bones. Drain them. Sack these two. Target them. Sack Gutter Bones, Gutter Bones. Make some more mana. Ooh, that was actually a really good draw. Because now I get to do that, and now I get to play Midnight Reaper. Okay, they're almost dead. So now next turn, also if I draw Swamp, I can go Dread Presence, Dome you, and like almost certainly kill you. Yep, the Priest of the Forgotten Gods was giving them the business. I respect that kill. Oh, that was a good draw. They are daubers. Think they realize they are daubers? Yes, they are daubers. So we go Dread Presence, drain with a Yara. Swamp Dome them. Cauldron Familiar, ping with a Yara. Boom, we did it! Nice. That was cool. So we went, what, 2-1? 2-1 in best of one games with bad kitties. I am gonna wrap up the little deck tech here. I just kind of want to showcase a little bit what it plays like against other decks. But I hope you enjoyed some bad kitties. This deck is super fun. It's, I think, my favorite deck in standard right now. It's not like definitely not the best by any stretch, but it is very fun. It's just like got a lot of cool, intricate interactions. If you are looking to play this deck, one of the things that I would think about is the sideboard. I think the sideboard is not amazing right now. I think it needs a little bit of help. I don't feel super confident about what it looks like right now. So I've been tweaking it around a little bit, but that's something you want to consider. The other thing is you might not want the Sir Conrad. I have some games where Sir Conrad's like so amazing, and then some games where Sir Conrad is like embarrassing, like, draft uncommon level and you're like playing standard. So I'm not really sure how good it is yet, but we will figure it out. Anyway, I'll make sure that this is, you can get the deck list on CFB. Like I said, I don't think you're gonna be able to export it straight into Arena, but you can definitely convert it and then you can try playing it. And if you do play this, I would love to hear what you think about it, how different your deck looks, if you're playing the red black variant or what. Also, if you like Arcane Lab and you are interested in having either something you've been brewing or something like that, I'd be happy to take a look at deck lists. I usually tweak things a lot before I play them, but I'm happy to give you like a shout out if you submitted a deck. And I don't know, I like playing different decks, so if you have any suggestions, I would love to hear it out. Thanks again for watching, everybody, and thanks again to Channel Fireball for sponsoring the series. This is going to be a continuing series where we're going to keep looking at some medium decks. And until then, I will see you later.